Hallelujah. How many of you would stand and say this morning, He is faithful? Come on now, I mean it. You know He is faithful to 1,000 generations. He's faithful. I don't even hardly know how I could stand there. I wanted to run, and I'm not a runner. Because He has been faithful when I have not been faithful. And don't stand there pointing a finger at me. You weren't faithful either. But God has been faithful in spite of you, in spite of me. He's as sure as the sun coming up in the morning. You fail 100 times, God will never fail. He will never forsake you. He will never leave you. He'll be with you to the very end of the age. He will never fail. Oh, I wish I could be more like Him. Don't you? Don't you? Don't you wish you could be more faithful? Don't you wish you were more authentic, more real? Come on, somebody, hear me today. I'm not pointing fingers in judgment. I'm asking us, do we really, really want what we got in here this morning? Or did we just come by here because it's the thing to do? Are we here today because we truly believe that He's at the right hand of the Father? We absolutely believe that He is the Lord of lords and the King of all kings. We truly believe that He rose from the dead, that He purchased salvation. And on that day or that night or that camp meeting, that youth camp, wherever it was for you, you got up from an altar having accepted Him into your life, and right then and there your name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Do you believe that this morning? Do you believe it? Oh, He's faithful. He's faithful. Hallelujah! Lord, You've been faithful. Oh, my Lord, You're faithful. You've taken me through the valleys. You've taken me to the top of the mountains. I've seen the good of the land, and I've dealt with the sorrow. But oh God, in it all, You have always been there. Every day of my life, I'm trying to give You praise, give You honor for all that You've done for me. I don't demand anything. I don't expect anything. I don't deserve anything. I've come into Your house this morning to worship. I've come in Your house this morning because I believe. I believe that You are faithful. And one day I'll stand in Your presence with the elders and the angels of God. One day I'll stand right there and I'll see You with my eyes. I'll hear You with my own ears. My faith will become sight. And I'll cry with the angels. I'll cry with the saints. I'll cry with the numbers of thousands and thousands and millions of people. And I'll only have one thing to say. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb to receive honor and power and glory and riches and wisdom. Glory to God. Oh, He is faithful. My Lord. The power of the Holy Spirit is here and He's challenging us today. We're getting ready for 2015. Going to be the baddest, biggest year we've ever had in this church. If you got problems, get over yourself. If you got an issue, get it in the altar. If you need to forgive somebody, get it done. It's time to throw the garbage down, get up, and start moving the kingdom for God's work. It's time for us to be the church of the living God. It's time to rise up. There's a whole bunch of itching ears out there. There's a lot of places filling up this morning because everybody's telling them what they want to hear. I'm here to tell you this morning, there is only one blood-filled gospel, and that is Jesus Christ dying on a cross to bring a transformation in your life. If you've not been transformed, you've not been touched. You've not been changed by God. I'm telling you, He promises you more than a half-in, half-out, half-hearted kind of wishy-washy experience. He's promised to give you a life completely transformed and changed. If you haven't experienced that yet, no wonder you're so discouraged. No wonder you're so disheartened, disillusioned, and deceived. But I'll say it again, and I said it a moment ago. God has not ever failed, ever. He's not failed you, sir. Get over it. He's not failed you, madam. Grow up. It's time to let the work of the kingdom arise. We ought to be more on fire in this hour than we have ever been in the history of this 100-year-old church. Because I believe with all my heart, and I need an amen if somebody agrees with me, we are the church, I believe, to see the coming of the Lord. I believe it with all of my heart. You've got to get out of your wishy-washiness. You got to get out of your mamby-pambiness. You got to get out of your wet noodleness. You wear a bow tie, you'll get bold too. You got to get over yourself. Start doing what's right. I'm not even preaching my message, but I'm preaching what's in my heart. Grow up. Get up. Do something. Roll your sleeves up. Get to work. We got work to do. There's lost, dying, and hurting in this world, and you're sitting on your old little offended seat. You won't move for nothing or nobody. God help you. But I'll tell you what I got to say. I got great advice for you. Get over yourself. Grow up. It's time for the church to become strong. It's time for the church to arise. It's time for this city to say, what's going on up there? What's happening up there on that hill? I'm telling you, I believe it this morning. I feel fire all the way to my feet. I've decided this morning, all the way here, change. It's time to change. Oh, I don't like change. Well, sit down, sweetheart. We'll let you know what happens. We're fixing to change. We're going to be challenged like never before. We're going to do God's work. We're not going to do your work. We're going to do God's work. I'll say that again. We're not going to do your work. We're going to do God's work. We're going to get busy doing the things of the kingdom, the things that really matter. We're going to prove to this city that Jesus Christ came to the earth, that He lived and died and rose again from the dead. We're going to prove that He's at the right hand of the Father. We're going to prove that He's coming again. Why? How? They'll know it. They'll know it when they see the love in our hearts and the giving nature of our spirit. I ought to write this down. That's a good message. Alyssa, that's good. You can write a song for that one. But praise God this morning. As we move into this 100 years, I make a promise to you, I'm going to do my very best to be the best pastor you've ever had. I prayed this morning and I told the Lord, I said, Lord, I'm going to pretend like this is my very first day and I got a lot of work to do. I'm going to work hard. I'm going to stay up late and get up early. I'm going to do everything in my power to minister to the babies, to the children, to the teenagers. I want to minister to the young marrieds and the young adults. And I want to minister to the middle agers. And I want to minister to the seniors. And I want to minister to the shut-ins. And I want to minister to the people out in the community. I want to find them wherever they're hiding and they're hurting. And I want every one of us to have a burden to lift them up and to put a brand new smile on their face, because we don't give them our answer to life. We give them His. How many of you know we've got the answer to the whole world right here in our midst? We got the answer to everything. They're in New York City trying to figure out how to control the protesting and the rioting and the killing. And they're sad as they go to the funerals. All I kept thinking as watching yesterday was, oh, they need the Prince of Peace. He's already here. Peace is already here. I got it. You got it? I got it right here in my heart. What are you lacking for, sir? Why are you so disillusioned? Why are you so weak in your faith? Why are you so unfaithful to God? He's given you everything. You have everything you will ever need right here in this very room. The presence of the Lord. That's all you need. You don't need nothing else. You've got the answer to every problem you'll ever have in your life. You don't know what I've been through. I don't care. It doesn't matter how deep it goes or how high it took you. All that matters is that you grab hold of Him. I see a picture. I see a picture of Peter. Peter, as he looks out across that troubled sea, and he says, Jesus, Lord, if that's you, bid me to come to you on this water. He literally asked, Lord, if it's you, then I need supernatural. I need a supernatural miracle right now. Jesus looked at him as he looks at every one of us in here today. Jeff, he looks at every one of us and he says this. He says, come. That's all he ever said. When he looked up at heaven and said, it is finished. The next thing that comes out of his mouth is come. 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 Peter got up out of that boat. He took that, can you imagine that first step? Got out of that boat. He could stand on top of that. Telling him there ain't a problem you got. There ain't a problem that's come your way. They ain't a person that's hurt you or offended you so deeply that you can't walk on top of it. You can get your freedom. It's here. The peace of God is here. The power of God is here. Joy unspeakable and full of glory is right in front of you. You've got it all. If you'll just come. If you'll just come. You got to respond. You got to do something. You can't just sit there. You can't just sit there. You got to position yourself. If I want to get in under the rain, there's sometimes in the summertime I'm real weird. I'll see a downpour. I love it. I'll go out in the backyard. I just get drenched. I love it. It's weird, I know. But if you want what God has already brought to the earth, it's there for the taking. You are living weak, angry, bitter, mad, offended. Why? Why? What shall separate me from the love of God? Neither height nor depth. Nor principality, nor angels, nor devils, nothing in heaven, nothing below the earth, nothing. What shall separate me? Nothing shall separate me from the love of God. You got everything you need. You got the answer to every problem. It's all right here for you. Hear this old weird dramatic preacher. God has ordained and stopped this entire service just for you. You are here today and you need what God is speaking to you right now. We need some folks in this church. Jeff? I've got to be careful. I still got to go home. And then I got to wrestle with me all day long. We need some folks that would take this gospel message seriously. That will take the work of the kingdom seriously. We need some volunteers to get involved in the battle to win the lost in this city. When Christ left, he looked at us and he said, because I go away, they're going fast. What does that mean? He knew that we were going to need everything we could get to do the work that he did. And he said, greater works will you do. Greater works will you do. You mean we'll do bigger things than Jesus? No, we'll do more. Because there's so many of us. God wants to use you. God's been trying to use your talent. He's been trying to use your gift. He's been trying to use you for a long time. But you sit there. Any number of reasons why, but you sit there. Today is a fresh start. Today is a brand new day, a brand new year, a brand new challenge. Yesterday is over. It doesn't matter about yesterday. What matters is right now, right here. Own up. Stand up. Accept the challenge. Get out there and be what God intended you to be. Let God use you. Let God use you. There have been miracles. There are miracles waiting for you to get out there where it's raining. Set yourself up in position and let it pour. But you missing the rain. Oh, I need to write this down. You're missing the rain. You're out of position. You're not where you should be, and you know it. You're uncomfortable. You're upset most of the time. You're a whiner and a complainer and a grump. Everybody knows it. They just put up with you. You're out of position. You need to get in the rain this morning. For he's been faithful. Come here. Sing it for me, Kathy. Oh, he's never failed. He's never let you down. He doesn't deserve how that you've treated his gospel and his work in your life. He's always been there. Sing it, Kathy. Could I get you to do something really out of order this morning? Would you get out from where you are and meet me in the altar real quick? Just get out. Anybody who's hungry, anybody who wants the rain, anybody who's tired of doing it halfway, get out of your seat and just meet me here in the altar. Receive from the Lord. morning, Lord. We honor you today, Jesus. Do the work in us. We give ourselves wholly, completely to you, Lord. Oh, take every part of us, God. We don't care what people think. We're not worried about what people will say. Lord, we just give everything to you. Oh, hallelujah. He's faithful. He receives you. When you walked into this altar, the moment you lifted your hands, he received you. He took you right in. He's going to answer the cry of your heart this morning. You ought to get happy about that. He's going to answer every cry that's in this house. I believe that this morning. Every sincere cry to the Lord, he's heard you. Hallelujah. 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 Would you turn around right now and just find someone to gently just lay a hand on their shoulder, very politely, very nicely. Just agree with them and pray over them right now. Husband, you might turn to your wife right there and begin to be the priest of your home and pray over her. Wife, you might pray for your husband. Pray for his strength. Pray for his blessing over his life. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We honor you this morning in the moving of your Spirit. Oh, Holy Spirit, you're challenging us. You're calling us into a higher place. You're moving in us, Lord, and we thank you for it. We honor the presence we feel in this place. Thank you, Jesus. You can be seated. I've got 20 minutes. I'm gonna wrap it up in just a few minutes. Your reservation is till 12 noon, so I've got you for 20 more minutes. Not allowed to check out early. Thank you, choir. The Lord used you this morning. The Lord's using you. Lay your hands on Pam, right where you are. Cindy, go over and lay hands on Pam. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. God, she's yours. In the name of the Lord, we thank you, Father. We honor you today. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. When no one seems to care, he's faithful. Oh, he's faithful. want to give the Lord praise this morning. If you stumbled in here this morning, welcome to Stratford Heights. You see, I've learned, I make no apologies for the moving of the Holy Spirit this morning. You see, what today is about is it's getting us ready for what I believe is going to be one of the greatest years in the history of this church. I'm claiming it, naming it, I'm being charismatic about it. I'm asking him, I'm pleading with him, I'm begging with him to give us the best year we've ever had. I want you to be a part of that, not an observer of that. I want you to be a part of that. I'm going to call on you. We're going to call on you to work. We're going to call on you to be a part. We're going to ask you to take up arms and help us in this battle to win the lost in this community. I want our church to be so busy doing the kingdom work that we don't even have time to sit down and be in the mully grubs. We don't have time to be depressed. Depressed is going to knock on your door and you're going to say, I don't have time. Get out of here. I'm not messing with you anymore. We're going to get strong in the power of the Lord. We're going to get mighty in him to the pulling down of strongholds. We're going to get strong in him. We're going to find ourselves able to leap over tall buildings with a single bound. Although that's Superman. Thought I was quoting scripture for a minute. There is a scripture that says, I'll leap over a wall and run through a troop. When my enemies come against me, I will rise up in the power of the Lord and I will conquer. Because his word promises me I will, you will. I'm challenging you as our pastor. I'm challenging you. Because you know, notice what I said, I'm challenging you as our pastor. I've been really praying the last couple weeks because I've been like, Pastor, I don't have a pastor. I am the pastor. And I don't have one. And you know what the Lord spoke gently to me? He said, the calling is pastoring you. So I'm challenging us as a church, as our pastor, into a deeper place, a stronger place than you and I have ever been before. I believe, and Brother Charlie confirmed it in the altar. He pulled on my arm just a few moments ago, and he spoke something to me. He said, God wants to do something here amazing. He wants to do something that is huge. He said, some folks are not going to stay because it's going to be so different. He said, but it's going to be God. He said, it's going to be similar to what you have seen at Brownsville. He says, well, God's going to do something in this church. And you know what? At first I thought, oh, that's precious. And then the Holy Spirit said, you doubt me? You doubt that I can pack this place out? That the lost, I can send them like fish into the net? You don't think I can do that? That when the hungry are searching, when they're looking, when they're starving for truth, that I won't send them to a lighthouse I've anointed? He said, get yourself in position for the rain. That's what I felt. I walked all the way over here and I just was having a little wrestling match with the Lord. I'm gonna believe him for big things. I'm gonna believe him for the biggest things. I'm gonna believe him for God things. Because I'm tired of man things. I'm tired of man-made programs. I'm tired of man-made junk. I'm tired of man-made philosophy and man-made sermons. I'm telling you, I'm at the place right now where I want a burning bush experience for Stratford Heights Church of God. I want the power of the Holy Spirit that guides and directs and puts a flame, a fire in the ministers. I've challenged every one of our pastors all of our teachers, all of our directors. I challenge every one of us to a place we've never been before. I want to move forward. I want to move forward in an unashamed kind of stance where we absolutely are ready for the reign of God to fall on this house. It starts with a challenge that I don't want to miss. I've got the preach on me. Can you tell? Janelle, you might need to start playing again. I'll calm down if you do that. Whenever you need me to calm down, just look at her and say, do it. She'll play something and I'll immediately go into a song or something. But I want to challenge you this morning. It's all right to laugh in church. It's all right to have fun. I want to have fun too. I told Cameron last night, I picked him up at the airport and I said, you know what? I want to have fun this year. I want to have fun. I want to laugh all year long. I want to be filled with the power of God. I want to see ministries explode. I want to see things happen. He said, man, let's get to work. I said, let's get to work. I said, let's get Richard. Let's get Gary. Let's get all the ministers, all the pastors. Let's get them all together and tell them, if you're not here to have fun, get out. If you're not here to see good things, great things, awesome things, then get off the team. I want to get to the place where we can't hardly stand ourselves because of the joy in here, because of the peace in here, because of the unity in here. You know, we can do anything if we'll just get unified, if we'll just start right there. You know, if we'll put aside all of our troubles and all of our doubts. Let me tell you something. There's something to be said for calling a church to a church-wide fast. And that's what I want to do before I get you. I've got 13 minutes. And I want to challenge you to something that I've got 23 pages typed here that I've prepared. And I'm just going, however many weeks it takes me, it'll probably take me 2 weeks, I'd say. I'll pick up next week and start off with this, and I'll finish talking about the fast found in Isaiah chapter 58. If you find Isaiah chapter 58, we'll be ready to go. Don't know if I'll get on that this morning, but I will either today touch on it if I got time, or we'll pick it up next week. But I want you to be ready from where we're getting, because starting next Sunday, I want us to begin, I'm calling a public fast. Now, there are private fasts. Your personal fasting with God is between you and God. But a leader, a pastor, he has a right. Scripture, there are times when they've called a solemn assembly and they've called a public fast. They've called the people to consecrate themselves. I'm calling you as our pastor. I'm calling our church. Corey, it's good to see you. Good to see you too, sweetheart. How are you doing? I need to stop visiting. Okay. I'm calling our church to a church-wide fast. A public fast. A public fast in this way means this. I'm not going to tell you how you are going to fast, but I'm going to call a public fast to our church for a couple of reasons. Number one, how many of you know the devil needs to be put on notice that Christ is alive and well in this place? We need to see the power of God. I'm tired of weak church stuff, churchy stuff. Tired of that. You already know how I feel about religious stuff. I don't like anything that smells churchy, religious-y. I love stuff that looks Holy Ghost-filled Christian. But I don't like all that churchy stuff. That doesn't mean I don't like tradition. Because I love traditions. Tonight, wonderful time we're going to come together. Hundreds come to the church. And last year, we know some of you waited 20, 30 minutes. And it was a little hot and it was a little, you know, it was long. So we worked hard to reorganize and rework that so that tonight when you come in, you can just float down to the altar and float right back out and you can have family communion and it'll be a good night for you. Come tonight. It's a sacred time, a traditional time. It's over 2,000 years old. We're going to pray over your family, anoint them with oil. We're going to share communion with just your family. And then we're going to pray over you for the new year and send you home. It's one of the most powerful times of the year we've ever had. People come, they bring their relatives, they bring cousins, they bring friends, they bring neighbors. They just bring them to stand in with their family, and that's all right. Anybody comes. You're welcome. I believe in the godly things, the good things. There are a public fast is voluntary. Understand this. Nobody's forcing you to fast. That's not biblical. It's not correct. God does not force anyone to fast. It's a voluntary action on your part. You can be a part or not be a part. You can do it or not do it. It's between you and God. And it's not that God's going to love you more if you do it or love you any less because you don't. He loves you just the same. So get that out of your mind, because some people are like, well, I feel so guilty, Pastor. I just can't do this or do that. Or don't worry about it. But for those who will, I'm calling us to a public church-wide fast. How long will you fast? I'm asking us to start January 4th, which is next Sunday, and we'll go all the way to the 24th. That's 21 days. We know that's what we have heard and learned and through the media, through Jensen Franklin, who has done a God-anointed work. We have learned the power of, once again, has hit the church concerning fasting. 21 days for those of you who will be doing, and most people will be doing, what we know as a Daniel fast. The first 10 days he did nothing but fruits and vegetables and water. I'm going to do something very similar to that the first 10 days. I'm just going to follow what Daniel did. But I know others are going to do different kinds of fasts. That's okay. I just want us to collectively, publicly declare a church-wide fast. There are different kinds of fasts. You can do the Daniel fast. You can do a partial fast. You can do a no food fast. But if you do that, don't go much longer than 3 days. If you go longer than that, you probably need to talk to your doctor even after 3 days. I don't know. But you need to talk to somebody concerning whether that's appropriate or right for you. God wants you to trust him, but at the same time, he wants you to be wise. And if you have sugar diabetes or if you have a disease where you have to have certain foods, we got to make sure you're okay and you can do what you can do and God will help you. So you'll work out a partial fast. But we are calling a partial fast, a full fast, a 21-day fast. 21 days. I'm going to fast 21 days. I'm challenging you to fast 3 days, 14 days, 10 days, 21 days. Don't go 40 days. If you go 40 days like people have, we'll be having your service at the end, unless God has called you. Now, if God wakes you up in the middle of the night and gives you a dream, says do 40 days, then you better do it. He's going to sustain you. He's going to keep you. And when you're done, the angels of God are going to minister to you. But I'm calling us to a church-wide fast. During the fast, it's also important that you understand, and part of what I'm going to be speaking about over the next at least 2 weeks, is we're going to be talking about that position, putting ourselves in position to where we can see the results of a fast. Now, you got to hear what I'm saying and what I'm not saying. I love what Jensen Franklin said I think it was a year or two ago when he preached on fasting. He said, fasting is not about manipulating God. It's not about demanding from God. It's not about pulling on God's coattail to get God to do something. You see, that's not what fasting is about. Fasting is about you. Fasting puts you in a position where the things you thought, things you felt, the things you were so determined and sure about are suddenly clearly revealed to you as wrong, and you are in this position now where you can sense, feel, and hear God. So then you're in position to be blessed. So when people say, oh, I fasted for so long and the answer came and God healed this or God did that or delivered that, it isn't because they got God's attention and made God heal them because they fasted. It was because they got in the position where in their life they now represented the holiness and the righteousness of God and his glory, and they were positioned in a place where they could receive from God. You see, sometimes we don't get it. We pray for things that we don't have any right to pray for because we're not living a righteous life. Oh, that's right. You guys are one of them holiness churches. You better believe it. I believe in the old-time holiness preaching of the Word of God. I believe that there is a right way to live, and when Christ comes into your life, he will transform you and change you. He will turn you upside down. He will change the way you feel, the way you think. I know I went down to be saved one way, and when I got up, I felt a whole different new way. I was a brand new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things had passed away. Behold, all things had become new. That's what he does. If you don't have that kind of experience, then you need to position yourself. And it starts at the foot of the cross, where we see the sacrifice of Christ. We acknowledge him, and we receive him into our life as Lord of our lives. Lord of our lives. You see, that comes down to the big problem. You see, a lot of people claim to say they're following Jesus. Sister Boyer, they say, I'm following Jesus. But technically what they're really saying, when they get up from an altar or a camp meeting or a youth camp, they pray that prayer, they get up, and what they've really done is they've decided to let Jesus follow them. You see, when you're determined that things need to be your way, in your time, that you're in control, that God answers your prayer, that God does it your way, then you're expecting that he'll be right there, following behind you as you lead. But if I'm following Christ, see, as a follower of Christ, then I'm saying, I give my life, my wills, my way, my thoughts, my hopes, my prayers, I give them to you. Nevertheless, thy will be done. Then God says, thank you. Now you're in position for a miracle. You see, that's the big mysterious secret. When you position yourself and you give God everything, he then turns around and he overwhelms you. He puts you in a position in that moment where he takes all your earthly ways of doing things and he turns them all into joy. He turns them into miracles, and he overwhelms you with his presence, with his power, with his reign. It's beautiful the way it works. God is a giving God. God wants you to give to him so that he can in return give back to you. I don't know why anybody wouldn't sign on. The devil does a real good job of deceiving people. He does a real good job of disillusioning people. And sometimes it's you that caused it. Sometimes because you're half-hearted, you're half in, half out, and you are the church. Sometimes because you're the church, other people don't want to be in the church. It's fun to be in this spot sometimes. And if I ever come in here wearing a bow tie, you better watch out, because I'm on a roll. I got to be having a courageous, bold day, or I wouldn't do this. Some of us, we're representing, and it's clearly pointed out in Isaiah chapter 58, verses 1 through 12. Go home and read that, and pray to God it ain't you. I said, pray to God it ain't you. Some folks who think they're representing, but because they do nothing but whine and gripe and negative and talk about folks, judge folks, condemn folks, got an attitude a mile and a half long because they sit there like that, they are misrepresenting the truth of God's word and God's power in their life. They actually, people look at them and say, if that's Christianity, I don't want it. I've actually looked at folks before, Sandra, and I have said, I don't want what they got. If they got Jesus, I'm out of here. If that's what having Jesus is, I don't want it. And you know what? There's a lot of people in doubt and discouragement and depression, and they don't believe, and they sit bitter lives, hurt lives out there in the world, trying to make it like the world is their answer. A good job is their answer. Getting a bigger house is their answer. A new car is their answer. They think all the answers lie in the moment. And poor them. But it might be that it was your fault. Maybe they looked at you, saw Jesus in you, and said, I don't want that. So this year, what I'm challenging us as a church to be, challenging us to be the church that Jesus put on a rock. The church that he put up on top of a rock, built it and said the gates of hell itself will not prevail against this church. I want to be not the Church of God or the Methodist or the Baptist or the United Church of Christ. I want to be the Church of Jesus Christ. I want to be that church. It doesn't have a membership role, but it does have a Lamb's Book of Life. I want to be that church. And that means there's going to be a cleaning house. And those that like to get on the phone and talk trash on the pastor, those who like to talk about how everything's going wrong, you know everybody's leaving. Yeah, I'm leaving too. When? Next year. You leaving? I'm leaving. Yeah, you leaving? Yeah, I'm leaving. Let's leave. Okay. See you at McDonald's. There's your drama skit for the day. I want us to get authentic and real, because to close, I'm actually going to read my scripture. And the scripture I'm going to preach next Sunday. So you'll have to come back next Sunday. And bring somebody with you. If every one of you brought one person, we would have this place jam-packed and have to put chairs down the wall. The church has got to be busy. The church has got to get to work. You need to bring somebody next Sunday. Gladys brought somebody precious. Listen to this. Pray it's not you. I pray it's not me. The word came to Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 58 in the very first word. And God said to Isaiah, cry aloud, spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Tell my people their transgression and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily. They delight to know my ways. As a nation, they actually do this as a nation that did righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They even take delight in approaching me. They say, why have we fasted and you have not seen? Why have we afflicted our souls and you take no notice? In fact, in the day of your fast, you find pleasure and you exploit all your laborers. Indeed, God says, you fast for strife and debate and to strike with the fist of wickedness. You will not fast as you do this day to make your voice heard on high. Is it a fast that I've chosen? A day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head like a bulrush and to spread out his sackcloth in ashes? Would you call this a fast and an acceptable day to the Lord? God says no. Is this not the fast that I've chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out, when you see the naked, that you cover him and not hide yourself from your own flesh and blood. Then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. He'll be all around you. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, "Here I am." If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger, speaking wickedness. If you extend your soul to the hungry, satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall dawn on the darkness, and your darkness shall be as the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually. Satisfy your soul in drought. Strengthen your bones. And I love this. You shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Those from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in. This is the fast God calls. This is the fast, as pastor of this church, that I call for us to get real, get authentic, put ourselves in position to where God can water his garden so that he can flourish in your life and mine. I'm calling us to a day of miracles. I'm calling us to a day of blessing. I'm calling us to a day where we will see light that will shine in the darkness. I love the story of a missionary that I read, and it's amazing. The story is, this gentleman went into the jungle. When he left his home, he said goodbye to his family. He was so all in. He was so authentic. He was so sold out to God that he went and he purchased a coffin. He filled it full of all his earthly belongings, sealed it up, shipped it with himself to the jungles. There in the middle of that African jungle, in a place where the headhunters had decapitated every missionary before him, they pulled that coffin out of the trailer, out of the truck, to put in his tent. And all the villagers looked on and was just like, "What is this guy's problem?" And he won them because he said, "I'm not leaving. The only way I'm leaving is in this box. And I already bought it. I'm all in. I'm here to tell you about Jesus." And the man lived, and he lived, and he lived, and he brought the gospel to that little jungle. And there is, his name is Al Milne. And on his epitaph, on his tombstone, the villagers wrote this inscription. It says, "When he came to us, there was no light. When he left us, there was no darkness." All in. All in. Stand with me. We've had altar, we've had prayer, but I haven't asked you a very important question. I'm going to ask you right now. With every head bowed and every eye closed, would you, for a moment, consider with me where you are with Christ? Have you accepted him as your Lord and made him Lord of your life? Is he your Savior? If you need Jesus, you need things right in your life this morning, you need a prayer that reconciliates you to him, that brings you back together with Christ, makes him Lord of your heart. If you need to pray that prayer, I want to pray that with you before we leave today. standing right where you are. An altar is made now at your seat. I would ask you simply, are you willing to pray with me that prayer for salvation? If you are, just slip up your hand. God bless you. Anyone else? God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Thank God for you. You're why I got up this morning. You're why these folks came to church this morning. We don't come here for us. We come here for you. Anyone else? Just a few seconds. Several have lifted their hands. Things going to get right in their heart with Christ. They're going to leave here different than they came in. Is there anyone else who wants to be a part? Anyone at all? All right. God bless you, son. God bless you, ma'am. Anyone else? Thank you so much. Heaven is getting ready to dance. All right, we're going to pray. Congregation's going to pray with you. But I want to tell you before we pray that right outside in the lobby, there is a discipleship booth there. You'll see it. It says, you know, discipleship on it, real big and clear. There'll be somebody standing there. They want to give you a Bible. They want to give you some information. They don't want to take anything from you. They just want to give you some resource. They want to help you to get established in your walk with Christ. Please go by and see them. Introduce yourself to them. They just want to look out for you. They just want to keep you in prayer and be there for you. If you have any questions, they want to help guide you. Please stop by there. Church, let's take them before the throne this morning together. I love this part. We get to walk them, Jamie, right up to the throne. And we get to do it together. Pray it like you never prayed it before. Pray this prayer with me. Dear Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. I know you're the Son of God. You died on the cross for me. You rose from the dead. You purchased my salvation with your blood. I accept you as my Savior. I call you as my Lord. I ask you to strengthen me. Help me every day as I strive to live for you. In Jesus' name, according to your word, I have believed in my heart. I've now confessed with my mouth. So I'm saved. As good as anybody. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. I look so forward to seeing you tonight. Please be here and come. It's open from 6 to 8. You don't have to come right at 6. You know, you can come at 7, 7:30, 8. You can come anytime during that time. And we'll be happy to be here and help pray with you and your family. God bless you.